This is Dharma Drops with your host, Rebecca Warfield. This podcast is a little bit about yoga, a little bit about life, and a little bit about whatever. And just as a warning, this podcast is unscripted, so that means I might regret a few things that I say. But hey, maybe I'll say some pretty awesome stuff too. Remember, these are musings, not truths. Buckle up, giddy up, because here we go. Okay, well, I'm really excited to be here.
Me too.
Thank you so much for having me in your amazing studio space.
Thank you.
How long have you been here? You just told me and I've already forgotten.
We've been here since the beginning of the year, mm-hmm. February, and then we just closed and remodeled, renovated, and have been here now for 2 months.
It's amazing. And for those of you listening, if you're wondering what we're talking about, this is your host, Rebecca Warfield of Dharma Drops Podcast, and I am with Summer Sobin, the creator, the founder, the curator, we are trying to decide the right word, the everything of Thousand Petals Yoga in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. Hey, before we get started, I want to let everyone know that it is September 6th, and it's just a few days after Hurricane Dorian left the Bahamas and left behind some of the most devastation I've ever seen in my life from a storm. And I had the fortunate opportunity of being in the Bahamas on Grand Bahama Island in May, and it was just amazing. Have you ever been to the Bahamas?
I have, years ago. Beautiful.
So beautiful. And the Bahamians are the kindest people collectively I think I've ever met in my whole life.
Yes.
So it's just really heartbreaking to see all this devastation. So Dharma Drops Podcast has launched a fundraiser that all donations will go to World Central Kitchen. And World Central Kitchen is an organization that's near and dear to my heart because they were in Wilmington, North Carolina last year after we were hit by Hurricane Florence. And they provide hot meals for free for survivors of either natural or humanitarian crises. And they are in the Bahamas right now feeding people. So I have a friend in the Bahamas who said they think it's going to be 5 more days before they have water.
Whoa.
Yeah, so at least they have meals from World Central Kitchen. So if you want to donate, you can go to dharmadropspodcast.com/the Bahamas and you can make your donation there. It goes straight to World Central Kitchen, so there's no weird third party stuff that you have to deal with. It goes right to the source, and we'll be raising money for them for the entire duration that they are in the Bahamas. The goal is to raise $100 for every hour that Hurricane Dorian sat on top of the Bahamas. So that's 50 hours. So that's $5,000. We're at about $560 right now. It's been, I think, a day and a half. So we're doing it.
That's amazing.
Thank you. So again, if you want to donate, go to dharmadropspodcast.com/the Bahamas. But in other news, I am here in Chapel Hill because of the hurricane, and I met Summer yesterday in a yoga class that was amazing. Thank you so much for teaching.
My pleasure. Yeah. I loved just meeting you. And I lived on the coast in Sarasota, Siesta Key Island, and feel like every time a storm would come and we would leave, I would meet new people.
Yeah.
And there's sort of this whole journey of every storm, every hurricane that would, create an opening. So it was kind of cool.
It was kind of cool. I know. I've been eyeballing the studio for a while, but when I've been here, it hasn't been open. I finally got to take a class, and I was so excited. It was such a good class, and I have to be honest, I've never sweat so much laying on my belly. We were doing, I don't know what we were doing yesterday. I was like, this is really hard, like laying on the belly and drawing the knee to the elbow.
Yeah, I've been geeking out a little bit on belly back bends and hip mobility and core mobility all from the belly. So I apologize, and you're welcome.
Yeah, apology accepted, and thank you. Actually, it's really good though, because I do have a low back injury. A lot of people who listen to the podcast already know that. And for a long time, prone back extensions did not feel good, but they've been feeling really good lately. And I was happy yesterday to spend so much time in extension laying on my belly and not have any pain. That was really good.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I think it's because the only way you can bring your knee to your elbow is to really use your core, you
yes.
know?
There's no cheating there.
No, unless you just lay down and forget about it.
Yeah. And if you keep working at it within a week, within 2 weeks, it's amazing how quickly your body responds.
Yeah, it's amazing how the body adapts so quickly.
Yes.
Yes. So you have an Anusara background. You are my first guest who has a background on Anusara. So I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about Anusara.
Okay, I'd love to.
Okay.
Yes, I first came into yoga through the Iyengar window. It was a studio down the road from my house, and I had been eyeing it for a while and just stepping out of a time of life where I needed something. And my husband and I at the time just kind of randomly one day said, let's go in there. Let's go check this place out. So we went in, and it was very strict.
Oh, yeah.
They were very serious. And I kind of love that. And we had no idea what we were doing. I was sobbing and crying and like detoxing the whole time. And the teacher would come bring me a box of tissues and say, you know, do you need to step out? I was like, no, I'm cool. I'm good. So we obsessively went to as many classes as we could pack in at that time. And one of the world-renowned Iyengar teachers, Ramanand Patel, happened to come through one of the weekends we were there. And he invited us to attend the teacher training program through that studio that weekend. Mm-hmm. He was guest teaching at. So here we are in that space with all these Iyengar teachers who know so much about the body, which gave me this profound level of respect for that tradition. Mm-hmm. And I realized soon that we were being used as the guinea pigs, as like how not to do everything. Yeah. And they were having us demo, and they were all kind of chatting and laughing and circling us and talking about all the misalignments. But luckily, my husband and I have a great sense of humor.
Which you can tell, by the way, from your website. It's amazing.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. It's been really fun. A labor mm-hmm. of love.
Yeah.
And humor is medicine.
It so is. Important. I'm really glad you said that, because I think I'm hilarious, but I like to tell jokes.
Yeah.
You know. Sorry, go ahead.
Laughter is so healing, especially right now.
For sure.
So we were, you know, getting prodded and poked and what have you and slapped. And I just laughed the whole way and fell in love with it. And we then went on to move. And this is when we moved to Siesta Key. And I, at that point, decided to do a teacher training program a little bit later down the line. And it was a mixed studies integrative program. So a little bit of this, a little bit of that, learning from all the different yoga traditions. And there was not a teacher there that held the level of skill that I saw out of the Iyengar mm-hmm. tradition. So it kind of had a very high bar. And in order to graduate, I had to apprentice so many hours in a teacher's classroom. And I told the director at the time, who's since passed away, that I couldn't complete the hours yet because I hadn't found anybody that I really wanted to apprentice with, and mm-hmm. I was really taking it to heart. So I think she was pretty annoyed by me, but supportive. And so I went home, and months went by, and finally in the local newspaper, I saw this article about a yoga teacher who had just moved to town. And her name was Betsy Downing, and she's so dear to my heart. She actually lives in this area now.
Oh, nice.
And she was an Anusara yoga teacher. And so I read, and through her writing, saw this level of integrity. And I then sent her now what is just the hilarious email. I was sort of interrogating her and interviewing her, like, so who are you? What's your background? You know, and she wrote me back the most exquisite, respectful, graceful, intelligent, loving note that was an invitation to come and just check out her class and see for myself.
Did I hear water?
We just heard water. I just cued water.
That's amazing. Yeah. I was like, what is that noise? Oh, there's pipes above us. I was like, I just heard something.
I was ignoring that. But yeah,
no, I'm sorry for bringing it to your attention, but I was like, what is that? Am I going crazy?
Yeah, that's my water feature, aka the toilet pipes above us. Look, I know all my neighbors' habits.
People have to flush the toilet. It's fine.
Yeah, it's fine. It's a metaphor during practice. Let it go. Let it go.
That's amazing. See, I knew yesterday in your class, I was like, she has to be on my podcast. I could just feel it. Because you kept saying things about, like, not, I don't know what you said verbatim, but basically, like, let's not take it all so seriously is yes. kind of what I heard. At least that's what I wanted to hear. Yes. You know? And so I was like, I think she has to be on the show.
I'm honored. Well, yeah. We call them the Fleshers. The Fleshers are back. They're the UNC students. Yeah. Just started term again. And so our whole studio knows them as the Flushers. And we love them.
They're probably amazing.
Flush away.
Flush away, guys.
Flush away.
So you found your teacher. She emailed you back a graceful and beautiful letter, is what she said, yeah?
Yes. And so I show up. My husband and I start showing up to her classes. And there she was. She was this goddess, both in her being, in her heart. You know, she's a PhD, brilliant thinker, speaker, teacher, all of it. She was so generous. After every class, she would sit with us and we'd ask a million questions and anatomical and yogic philosophy. And she was just so generous. And at that point, the Anusara alignment that she was teaching was, it felt very heady to me. Mm-hmm. And I still decided I was going to be open to it and just try it on in the body. It was, some of it was counter to the Iyengar system, which I know a lot of people say it was sort of a copy of, but having had a little bit of a taste of both, I can say there are many things that are different. There's a lot of inspiration as well.
Sure.
So I was relearning and reworking things in my body, and my body was healing and opening and strengthening. And so on that level, it was lining up. And then she said, you know, the founder, John Friend, would be coming through town, come check out a workshop. So we decided to go. And when we met John, he was so charismatic. He had this, what he called the tour bus that he was on, where his group of, you know, all the people that worked with him would travel around the country. And it was sort of this nod to the hippie times. And it was really fun. It was a little bit campy. And I, when I met him, had a lot of hesitation because of all of that, honestly.
Sure.
And it really wasn't a flavor package I was looking for, but his being, his heart, and his love for the practice and serving others just was obvious.
Sure.
And so throughout that weekend, he began to bring in some of the philosophy, and that the Anusara system was rooted in the tantric philosophy, and that's a big umbrella term for a whole lot of stuff.
Sure, but which I think is often misunderstood.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's not what you Google.
Yeah. I have a friend who, she is back in North Carolina now. She's actually going to be on the show soon. Unfortunately, she's back from chemotherapy, which is a real bummer, but she's amazing, first of all. CA, hello, we love you. But she was actually working in a tantric school in Ecuador, and you know, she has such amazing stuff to say about it, and I want to learn more about Tantra. I've never been one who thought it was not, that it is what you Google, right? There's all this like weird stuff about Tantra that you Google, but this idea of just experiencing the pleasures of this lifetime, you know? Because I think a lot of time in the spiritual practice, there's this like renouncing everything,
yes.
You know? And I really like this, hey, we can enjoy our lives. It can be full and robust and we can love this experience.
Absolutely. And that right there, you just hit it. He was articulating that, and I just, at the time, could not imagine that that was true, that that was a path from the past that I had come from the family that I had come from. I just had never heard anybody saying how wonderful life is, how divine embodiment is, that we can use the senses, and mm-hmm. that divinity is everywhere. It's here, you know, it's not about cleansing or purifying ourselves to be good enough or getting all the forgiveness we need because we're impure, we're sinners.
Right.
It was exactly just this arrow in my heart. And I decided in that moment that I was either going to prove him wrong, because it really grabbed me. I was either going to prove him wrong or it was going to be right. My life would transform.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was that piece that I decided to stick around with him and went on a long journey, being his student, being in that community, which I think one of the greatest gifts that Anusara yoga, and it still exists today in a different form that I can't really speak to now, but when he was sort of at the helm at that time, the community of teachers, the community of students was the gold. It really was this family. I could go anywhere in the world, anywhere in the country, and instantly know I had someone to call on to sleep mm-hmm. at their home, to share a meal with, to have this connection of awakening with. And I'm just so grateful to him for holding this huge vision of what he brought forward. Mm-hmm. On the physical level, he brought through his system of biomechanics, which a lot of still informs my teaching today after over 20 years of teaching. A lot of those principles for me are really what heals my students. They're principles of empowering people to know themselves, to feel safe to try new things, to over a period of time progress and really heal injuries, let go of emotional pains and wounds, mm-hmm. and really to live into that vision and that invitation of life is good.
Yes.
Something to celebrate. It's not a battle. It's a dance.
I keep thinking about my own experiences just growing up, just going back to what you were saying about, you know, life is good and we aren't just bodies of sin that need to be purified. Because I grew up in a Presbyterian home but went to Catholic school, both very traditional backgrounds where the body was really to be shamed, right? And to enjoy pleasures in life. In fact, my dad's dad, so my paternal grandfather, was a very strict Presbyterian minister, about as close to Puritan as you could get in modern times. Without actually being like a Puritan, you know, and they weren't allowed to have sweets. They weren't allowed to wear bright colors. So there was this, my family wasn't like that, but there was always this sort of undercurrent of that. And so to know that there's a philosophy out there that's just like, enjoy this body and enjoy this life. That's amazing.
Yeah.
It is amazing. And without shame, because I had a guest on here, Gabby Maradiz. She is an amazing artist and she does a lot of work with women and pleasure. And it's not sexual pleasure. It's about how can we feel pleasure in our lives and not be ashamed of it? Because mm-hmm. often it accompanies shame.
Yes. Especially mm-hmm. for women.
Yes. That's her big thing.
Yes. I right now find myself really lingering and focusing in the direction of like the way of beauty, the path of beauty, mm-hmm. which is all of this, what we're talking about, and relearning sensuality, again, not necessarily sexuality, but not including that. It's
right.
Food, it's color, it's life. You know, we were recently leading our retreat in Italy, and man, so much love for those people.
They can live some life.
They are masters. Mm-hmm. And I know there are things about their culture and politics,
sure.
you know, everywhere, not glorifying everything, but they are masters of embodiment. Mm-hmm. I love how they roll. I am a student of their culture.
I'm an eater of their food.
Absolutely. Drinker of their wine.
I am a drinker of their wine too.
They do it right. Every time I come back, I have a little bit of heartbreak mm-hmm. to return here, not because I don't love our country and love so many of the freedoms that we have and all of that, but there is, for me, a feeling of loss because we don't have tradition and culture in the way that many countries do.
I talk about this a lot with dance. Yeah. So I'm a dancer. So Summer and I just met. So if you guys are wondering why I'm telling her these things that you've heard me say 1,000 times, it's because we're new friends. But I'm a dancer. And I always feel really bummed that the United States does not have a collective cultural dance. So now part of it is because it is a multicultural nation. I get that. Yeah. But you go to some countries and it's just like, they just have this culture about it that's so vibrant,
yes.
you know, and it's like, it goes all the way to the core of who they are, you know. We were in Portugal a few years ago, and I will say this one guy, he came up to my boyfriend, he was like, you know why I love Americans? Because just like Portugal, you love America, and we love Portugal. And he was like, we understand that. And I was like, well, we do have that. We do have that.
That is down.
Yeah, we have that. We're good at that one.
So good at that. Yeah, the like, lineage and the just the history mm-hmm. of dance, the history of food. I mean, just shoulder and shoulder and shoulders to stand on for everything. I think our culture has this invitation to, instead of going against diversity and to separate and all the illness that's showing its face right now in society, is it's actually refreshing to see, but it's also a time I want to celebrate all the cultures and mm-hmm. and just relish that that is a celebration of the divine coming through all these facets, all these faces, colors, form, religions. It feels to me we can go in either direction. And because we don't have a lot to stand on here in one root, there's something unique about it. And we have to really hone in and get sensitive to what is unique and how can we work this rather than going towards the dark side.
And I think it's in a really interesting time. I can only speak for the American West when I say the West, because that's of course where we are. But I think it's almost like a test. You know, like now we are faced with all these opportunities of diversity to witness that, but can we also see past the veil of it all and past the illusion? Because I think we have two choices. We can see diversity or see, you know, the differences in cultures or whatever we're looking at as separate and other, or we can make that choice. Hey, yeah, sure, we are diverse and that makes for an amazing community and culture. But when we look past that, can we see the oneness?
Yes.
It's a test. And I think it's interesting how many people are practicing yoga and looking into these spiritual practices and starting to discover like, oh, shoot, this is all Maya, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I think collectively we might say we're not doing so hot in the test.
Yeah.
But I do think more and more individuals are awakening.
Yes, I do too.
And that whole tipping point thing is real. And rock on, everybody keep going and don't lose hope. It's so important that we know that we as individuals really do have an impact on the whole. Mm-hmm. And so even though it can feel like we're fighting against something bigger than is possible to transform, I really truly believe in hope. I'm always going to end up in optimism no matter what. I recently, through my daughter's school, it's a Waldorf school, we hosted a biodynamic farmer
and beekeeper. That's cool.
Gunter Hawk. This man is amazing. Spikenard Farms Sanctuary is a brilliant place in Virginia where he not only teaches people how to take care of the bees, not honey-centric beekeeping, but to give back to the bees, to respect the bees, to be humble to them, and because our survival depends on them. Mm-hmm. But his slogan for the sanctuary is hope until the very last flower.
Oh, that's amazing.
That speaks so deeply.
That's really beautiful.
Yes.
I do agree that collectively, maybe there's some problems. I mean, maybe is not the right word. There are some problems happening. But I do feel like in the last 10 years, and maybe it's because I've made the choice to hang out and, you know, build a community or build my own community with other like-minded people or something. But at least I do feel like there's this shift. And I work with young people. So I work at UNC Wilmington. And they are different creatures.
Yeah.
They really are. And they, you know, it's been almost 12 years ago now that I started teaching English at UNC Wilmington. And I was really worried 12 years ago. I was like, oh my God, is this where we're headed? But I feel really good in a lot of ways, especially this semester, the students I've met, I'm like, okay, I think we're going to get somewhere.
Yes.
They have meditation practices. They have yoga practice. I mean, even outside of yoga and stuff like that, they're just open and they're flexible and they're willing to try things. And it's been really cool to see that change.
Yeah, I agree. I love being around younger people. Mm-hmm. I love seeing, it's kind of like a different ray, like a color of the rainbow. They come in downloaded differently. Their software is different.
Yeah.
And there's just, I mean, they have to be equipped. I have, you know, two young children and they are equipped for the times. So mm-hmm. I think about what 20 years will look like for them. And we don't know. We don't know what the future holds truly with the planet, with food security, all of these very real things. But what I do know is these beings who have embodied seem to have something of a force of their mission, of what they're here to do. And if we can continue to foster them in the direction of staying awake and empower them.
Yeah, it's exciting to see.
Yeah.
So I guess we will see what happens. You know, it's interesting being a teacher. I've watched the generations change. You know, every semester I feel like things are a little bit different. But this particular semester, I feel really hopeful. They're like all fresh out of high school. A bunch of them are 17 years old. And I just feel like, okay, we're going to be all right, everyone.
Yes. I love it.
I hope so. Don't let me down, PED 101.
We're all depending on
you. The whole world's depending on you and your ballet class and your yoga class that you're taking with me.
No pressure.
No pressure at all. So I don't know how we got here, but we were talking about Tantra and Anusara. That's right. So your Anusara journey, that's what we were talking about. Yes. So what was the next step along the way?
Okay, so then, let's see, John Friend really became this incredible teacher of ours. And I think he is a masterful asana teacher. Mm-hmm. I have so much gratitude to him. And I just love my memories of that time. Mm-hmm. I love his brilliance, his love of empowering all the teachers that he did. There's so much there, and I have just nothing but gratitude for him. We then went on in our own classes, to apply these principles for years and years, and got to see firsthand students transforming, people healing. Mm-hmm. My husband and I, when I say we co-taught together, our paths have always been combined. We co-owned our studio together.
That takes a special couple, I think, to be able to work together and to practice together and to live together.
Oh, yeah.
That's special.
We have a story, a rich territory story. Yeah, we've walked through fires. Our relationship is very much about transformation, mm-hmm. and walking through it together. And somehow the alignment's been there, through the yoga, through healing our past, before pre-yoga healing, all the way into parenting and just continuing to help each other evolve. And our teaching now is very much, so we stepped away from the Anusara about the time that the implosion happened.
Yeah.
And, I'll just say to the implosion, whatever it's called.
I like the implosion.
The implosion, capital T.
Yeah.
It was a time already for us, and I'll even say for me, I'll let him speak for himself, where we were feeling a call to kind of let go of form.
Mm-hmm.
And could tell that there were things shifting, and energetically in the community, there was a lot of projection always, mm-hmm. towards John, and there was a lot of him also playing that part, which I don't need to comment on, but it was feeling ready to dissolve,
mm-hmm.
and almost like the hurricane was coming and it was time to offer up whatever that form was for that particular group, for that particular time. And so when we eventually stepped away, it was not in response so much to allegations. I don't care if John smoked pot or who he slept with, consenting adult wise. That's none of my business. And I look back with just nothing but gratitude. And it was interesting that timing was coming for me with all of that at the same time.
Well, we cultivate a sensitivity in yoga, and I think we can feel these things happen. Everything ends, right? Everything has a beginning, middle, and end. And I think when you cultivate sensitivity, you can feel the rumblings of things before they start to fall apart.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. The ground was shaking, and I just really hope for him now. I wish him well. I wish him whatever lessons were meant to come out of that is settling, mm-hmm. and I believe in him. I don't have any reason to feel otherwise. I know other people have a lot of opinions and what have you, but
these things are complex.
They're so complex.
I read an article by Kino McGregor a long time ago, and it was in response to when all these allegations were coming out about Patavi Joyce, mm-hmm. and his hands on assists and stuff. And she mentioned the article, I forget what it was called exactly, but it alluded to this is why women don't always speak out. And it was talking about how complex these relationships are, because people who do things that maybe normally you would just be like, this is unbelievable, I can't accept this. But if you happen to love that person,
yeah,
it's complex.
It's very complex.
It's very, very complex. And you can feel lots of, the human experience is so weird. We can feel lots of things at one time. We can love someone and also not be okay with things that happen, or we can be okay with things that are happening and not love a person or whatever, you know? So we just fall somewhere on this very complicated spectrum.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And we're all human, you know? For me, I'm not looking for a guru. I've never looked for a guru.
You. I feel like a big sigh of relief. I'm always worried if someone's like, you know, my guru. I'm like, oh no, I can't talk about this.
Yeah, I'm not interested in that model. I think it's a patriarchal model maybe still resonates for some. I'm not saying that there aren't gurus out there, but the guru principle, the weighty one is what that word is, the heavy, the one who illuminates the dark. I believe in that principle, and the tantric teaching on guru, which I love, and I want to give mad props to Douglas Brooks, Rajanika Yoga, if you want to learn more about his lineage, his teachings of tantra, the goddess tradition that he holds. Thank you, Douglas, for all the amazing gifts that you've given me. More than any teacher in the yogic philosophy realm, he has turned my world upside down.
Oh, I feel like inspired. I actually have some books of his, and I think he just did a workshop in Boone recently that a number of my friends went to.
Oh, to know Douglas, you have to sit with him, and he will take you on a journey. And you will never be linear on that journey. You will have no idea where you are.
Doesn't matter.
There's a Sanskrit word, ujjayi, which is to flip everything upside down. I think he really embodies that.
Ujjayi. I don't think I've ever heard that Sanskrit word before. It's interesting.
Yeah, to kind of flip it inside out, right? And he kind of airs everything out, forward, backwards, upside down, and brings you back home again. For instance, I remember years ago doing this workshop with him on Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. I'm so excited. You know, this is like my first crack at the text, sitting with this incredible teacher. And I remember the first 2 days he was giving the whole back history, time, place, you know, where we're looking in history, and like the Russian doll opening up all these endless perspectives. And then by the last hour of the third day, he began to break down the very first sutra of the text. And I think we only got to the very first word of the text, which some people might get very annoyed by that, but I loved it.
Atta, so was it 1.1? Atta. Do you know how much time I have spent in my poor UNCW students? They're probably like, this lady is crazy. I spend so much time on Atta because I'm like, can you ever really get past that?
Can you ever get past that? And that's why that text is created. That's exactly the point.
It makes me feel really funny inside in a good way when I think about it. I'm like, we can't get past now.
Yeah.
For those of you listening, if you don't know what Atta is, it's now, right? And this idea that now is now and you're never going to be in any other moment.
Yeah. And if you don't get now, then you go on to read the next words and you read the whole sutra and you still don't get it. Okay, now read the next sutra. You still don't get it. And then we end up reading the whole book.
I know. It's so interesting. When was the last time you took a writing class? Maybe, I don't know, a kabillion years ago. If you are a yoga studio owner, a yoga teacher, a wellness professional, a personal trainer, whatever, a health coach, whoever the hell you are, if you have a wellness business, it is time to take your business to the next level through written content. But you might be thinking, God, I don't know how to write because it has been a billion years since I took an English class. Well, I am offering an online course, Business Writing for Wellness Professionals. I've been teaching composition at a university for the last 12 years, and I am now merging my work with writing into my work with wellness. And I'm here to help you gain confidence as a writer, write smarter, not harder, and take your business to the next level through written content. Because after all, even though we're living in this digital age that maybe everything seems to be in images, everything we do is accompanied by copy and written content. So if you're interested in blogging, your social media posts, building copy for your website, whatever it is, if you are working with written content for your wellness business, please join me for Business Writing for Wellness Professionals. The course includes online content that you'll have access to for life, and we'll meet 3 times online, October 2nd, 9th, and 16th, where you can get one-on-one coaching, one-on-one guidance, plus collaborate with other industry professionals because we'll be meeting together. To register and to learn more, head over to dharmadropspodcast.com/offerings. You can get more information and register, but don't wait. I only take 6 participants, so that way you can get one-on-one feedback and one-on-one attention. So make sure you head over there and register ASAP. Again, that's dharmadropspodcast.com/offerings. See you there. Dharma Drops Podcast is now available on the Podcoin app, and it is the podcast player that pays. Not only can you listen to Dharma Drops, but you can listen to all of your favorite podcasts on Podcoin. Just get the Podcoin app on iPhone or Android. It's free and super easy to use. And you can use the app to then earn Podcoins that you can trade in for gift cards or to donate to charity. And there's pretty sweet gift cards on there like Athleta, Amazon, Starbucks, and more. But even better, you can use all of your Podcoins and then donate to a charity, which is really in the true Dharma Drop spirit. I've been using the Podcoin app to listen to all my favorite podcasts because, hey, I'm listening anyway. I might as well earn something. So get the Podcoin app and use the invite code Dharma Drops. That's DHARMA drops. And you'll get 300 Podcoins just for signing up if you use my code. Again, that's the code Dharma Drops. And you get 300 Podcoins if you use the code Dharma Drops, DHARMADROPS, Dharma Drops. Okay, friends, go get you some free stuff. The most masterful teachers I've ever had were similar in that sometimes I'm like, what are we talking about?
Yeah.
And then at the very end, I'm like, oh, and not just yoga teachers, yeah. Even like my graduate school professors, the ones that I mean, it's not even that I learned the most from that changed me. It changed the way I see the whole world. They were masters at like talking in this circle, almost a spiral. And then suddenly there we were. Yes. I was like, oh, that's amazing.
Teachers to me are such a profound gift in life. It makes me think of John O'Donohue. He wrote many beautiful books and books on prayer and mysticism. If you've never heard the interview with him, and I believe it's Terry Gross.
I haven't.
Run and listen to the unedited. It is life in a nutshell and a conversation with him right before he passed away.
But just got cold chills.
Yes, this will change your life. He wrote a book called Ahamkara, which is essentially soul friendships, this whole book on the power and the gift of friendships. And I would say that there is also in that same vein, the power and the gift of teachers, the someone who is empowering another with wisdom and knowledge and support to kind of help you move through whatever you're learning, whatever you're manifesting, you know, meeting you where you are and willfully giving you tools to move forward is one of the greatest human relationships.
It's always amazing to me too how teachers arrive. I've always had this weird thing where I seek teachers. I think part of it is from a very complicated childhood in Catholic school. I was like terrified of my teachers, you know, and not in a good way. Like recently Annie Carpenter was in Wilmington and I was scared of her in the sense that like when I wasn't using my quad, she smacked me and I was like, okay, got it. Not scared like that. Scared like this nun is crazy. Kind of scared.
Don't piss her off.
Do not piss Sister Corda off, okay? Because she will get you. But I've always been sort of seeking for teachers. But it doesn't work like that. They just arrive. You know, maybe sometimes you leave home for a hurricane and you meet an amazing yoga teacher. And you're like, wow, that was just like a life-changing class, you know? Or maybe you're having an argument with someone and you learn so much about yourself and that person. You know, it's not always someone who just gives you these, quote, gifts.
Yes.
The teacher just emerges when you're ready for the lesson.
And that is tantric. That is the guru.
Maybe I'm a tantric yogi and didn't know it.
You definitely are, by the way. You definitely are. Your worldview is definitely aligned. And it's seeing the one, seeing whatever name you want to put in there, but the teacher looking out through the eyes of whomever you're with, every experience, everything, the good things, the hard things, everything as an invitation to awakening an invitation to knowing yourself more deeply. There's nothing exempt from this, which can be really intense medicine.
Yeah.
When really bad things, what we want to label as bad, happen, painful things happen. And I have been in awe. I've had, I'm thinking of one person in particular, a yoga student who's lost a son, and watched her grieve and go through that whole process. And just seeing the grief in the body, seeing the tears, the pain, but then watching her over time transform it and seeing how that lesson that she wouldn't obviously never have wished for, or even if you ever knew it was coming, you'd never know how you could ever live through it, but how that tore her heart open and is the driving force of who she is today. And so all these behind the scenes, you know, that happened through events that we would never want to have happen, but that is the guru principle in action right there.
Yeah. But how hard is that? You know, and I don't think everyone's ready for that.
No.
I think that not everyone's ready to see even the world's worst experience, the most heart-wrenching experience, to become a teacher.
Yes, it is a big ask. It's a very big ask. And small steps, right? Little ways that people can begin to have gratitude for hardships that they've learned from, and whether it be God put that in my path, or just whatever the framework is, I think many can agree that those things provide us growth and potentially evolution, however we meet them.
It's so much work to do, but it's so amazing.
It is amazing.
What a cool gift we have in the yoga practice. And I know this all the time, but sometimes it just hits me really hard. Like, this is a really amazing thing that we do, for sure.
It's mind-blowing. Like, literally blows my mind.
Sometimes it really does blow my mind. I'm like, what in the world? I have these, like, fleeting moments where I'm like, this is beyond even comprehension.
Well, even as hatha teachers, to do the practice in the body, and to get out of so much of the thinking realm, get out of thought, the therapy that comes just through moving the body and breathing, and all of the deep work that's happening under the surface when we hold a posture, when we align our intention, when we open to the breath. I know anybody who's been on a dedicated path of practice has experienced transformation, and it's hard to put words to it. It's hard to label what's happening, but, you know, going back to Yoga Sutra, it's abhyasa, it's show up and just keep showing up and without attachment, and you will see that you are in this river of something very powerful that is helping you be embodied, that's helping you be more your creative self, that is giving you tools for dealing with the world today. It's helping you learn the power of attention and focus, all the things that we need for life. And I know that yoga is just one avenue. It's not the only one. And I'm always falling in love with the practice over and over again.
Me too. You mentioned yesterday, actually, in the opening of class, the attention span change. What was that again? I forget what you said.
Yeah, so the recent stat that I read was within 5 years, the average human's attention span used to be 15 seconds, and now it is 3 seconds.
I mean, 15 wasn't even that much.
15 was bad. We were already bad. Now we're at 3, which apparently is less than a butterfly.
Okay? Oh, whoa.
We are bad.
So the whole, like, squirrel joke, you know, that's even more than what we have.
Oh, yeah. We wish we were squirrels.
But I like what you said, though, because I think, of course, a lot of people know that yoga is more than just exercise, but I think sometimes we forget the importance of concentration. And everyone talks about meditation, right? People talk about their meditation practice all the time. But I think sometimes we forget that meditation comes from concentration, right?
Oh, I'm so glad you're saying this.
Yes. Too, actually, because I think it's something important to mention. And my boyfriend listens to Joe Rogan's podcast all the time. Joe Rogan, if you're listening, I just need you to say Dharma Drops podcast once on your show. Take it to the next level for me. Just
do it.
Just do it. But he was saying, he came home, he's like, this guy that I was listening to on Joe Rogan's podcast was talking about how he, you know, concentrates on meditation to meditate, you know, and I don't know, I didn't hear the whole conversation, but I was like, yeah, that's the difference between dharana and dhyana. You know, there's, you concentrate in the effort to meditate, you know, and the yoga practice for me, it's one of the only ways I can really start to concentrate. Because I love fine alignment. That's why I enjoyed your class yesterday. I love to get into the nitty gritty details because I can really just concentrate.
Yeah, it's this is such a place of passion for me right now, actually. I'm teaching a meditation series and focusing right now on separating that out. So there are concentration practices. Mm-hmm. And then those lead into the state of meditation. And concentration on the breath could be an example, or counting your breath backwards, concentrating Vipassana style on different feelings, textures, mm-hmm. sensations. And in the asana realm, we are learning that, we call it ekagrata, that one-pointed focus. Mm-hmm. And we're learning how to feel multiple things at one time. We're in this training ground for how to be attentively present. Mm-hmm. And presence is power. Presence is everything. I always remember learning about acting, and not that I'm an actress, but just hearing that one of the ways they would teach people to be in love on stage was you would look directly into the eyes of the other. You would give them all of your attention and energy, and that would relay love to the audience. And that says it right there, that attention is love. Attention is creative energy. It's Shakti. It's life force. Mm,
I like attention is love.
Attention is love.
Because, I mean, think about how nice it is to offer someone. You may have mentioned this yesterday because I feel like this is coming back to me. Offering someone your attention. Did you talk about this in class? Okay. Because suddenly I was saying, I'm like, I don't think I created this idea.
You should own it and take it and
but
share it.
It was yours. But like to give someone your full attention, that's a lot. And I'm really bad at this because, you know, I run a digital business. I have a podcast and I can't tell you how many times someone's been talking to me. I'm like, hang on one second. Let me just finish this post.
Yeah.
It's so bad. I have to get better about it.
Yeah. And just training ourselves not to multitask and putting weight into the moment. And right now, right here, wherever now and here is the only moment where life really exists. So I'm so deeply inspired by Jeff Carrera. I want to give him a shout out. Jeff is a meditation teacher, and also his peer and teacher, Craig Hamilton. These men are doing really profound work, in my opinion, which I know they're coming out of a different tradition, meditation tradition, but it's so tantric as well. Talking about awakening, what is awakening? What does it mean to not insist anymore that right now isn't enough? Mm. And that contemplation has been such a huge game changer for me, because on the very, very deep under layers in the unconscious realm, I think we all are swimming in a society, swimming in a world where the voice is saying something's wrong, something's bad, something's missing, something's off. And we could link that to the malas, the dust that cloaks the light of the spirit, which is like what we're doing the Windex for in our practice. We're clearing the dust. But that voice is then coloring everything. And when we're not able to drop in and say, you know what, right now I'm going to be all in. The party's here. There's nowhere else to be. The whole FOMO fear.
The party's here.
The party's here. There's nowhere else to be. There's nothing else that I need to be doing, whether it is sitting here or, you know, if I'm with my kids. I struggle with this, right? I have 50 other things to do and my kids need me. You know, really my training ground is parenting. It's like, nope, they walk in the door, boom, I'm on. I have to give them my all. And it's my hardest work, but it is what I'm dedicated to doing, because I believe that is love. And they feel when you're halfway there. They feel when you're not really available. And it's also linking me into the depths of my spiritual practice, which is I try to share this in nuggets through my teaching, but if we are in multiple time zones, like our head is over here, and our head could be in a million time zones at once, our body is in another location, then we have all this feeling happening, and we don't have time to feel it, so we're trying to shove that down, numb that down. We're just split. We're living in all mm-hmm. these places, and then we're so dissatisfied. And we really feel a longing and a sadness, like something is missing. There has to be more. And I think the answer is actually it's all already here. It's not like practice yoga or practice meditation to then fix it and be a different person one day, better person, fingers crossed, it'll mm-hmm. all come together. But no, right now in all of this feeling, mess, clutter, life, it is right here. It's actually the point of opening. And if we can have attention and learn to de-escalate our fears and our reactions and breathe with it, then it really is like the opening to, you know, what these tantric texts are teaching us. It's not something other or something for people sitting in a cave. It's the householders, those of us mm-hmm. who are in the world. This is it. It's hard.
It's really hard. I keep thinking about, are you familiar with Bill Mahoney? He's a bhakti teacher.
I love Bill Mahoney.
Me too. I love Bill Mahoney. And I went to a workshop with Bill Mahoney. And in fact, I think I mentioned this on the episode that came out today. We're recording this on September 6th. So the episode came out today with Johanna Beekman. She's a kirtan artist and a bhakti yogi. But I was telling her, and I'll tell you, that in Bill Mahoney's workshop, he used this phrase that God is love.
Yes.
And so that means love is God. And so to experience one is to experience the other. And the word God doesn't always resonate with me, back to that whole Catholic school thing, you know, doesn't always resonate with me. But I really like attention is love, because to pay that close attention, if that's to love, then that's also God or consciousness or the universe or whatever it is.
Yes.
You know, it taps into something so much greater. It's not just about attention,
yes.
right? It's not just about like, oh, now I'm not thinking 500 things. It's no, now I'm connected.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Training ground. And
yeah.
Bill is just an exquisite heart, mind person.
He sees you. If you want to talk about attention
yes.
is love, he sees you. From the moment he walks in the room, he sees you.
And that's what I'm talking about. The embodiment of this, when you're in the presence of someone who is there like that, it is so healing, and it's such an invitation for you to come forward and be yourself. They're not distracted or kind of giving this message, you're not enough, or I have other important things to do. I am just so moved, and that is my practice, to let everyone that I encounter know, you are enough. I'm interested and the unique gifts that you have, what you're bringing forward, and to always see that light and that goodness mm-hmm. in the other as a true living aspiration of mine. Even difficult people, which they're going to always be there in life.
Your best teachers.
They are the best teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And even when you have to set boundaries, even when it can get painful, to say, and I still see you. I see the part of you that mm-hmm. is that.
You know, when I met Bill Mahoney, I've only studied with him one time in real life, but I've read his books. He's amazing. I had mentioned to him in passing that I teach at a university, that I teach English. And the entire time he was like, oh, then in the workshop, you probably know this piece of literature. And I noticed he wasn't just doing that with me. He took the time to know everyone just a little bit. Mm-hmm. And that's really skillful.
So skillful.
I don't know how, because sometimes I'm like, wait a minute. I know you told me your name 10 times. I'm sorry. I can't remember. You know what? Yeah. I can't. I feel like there's so much happening. I mean, that's just maybe a testament to his own practice to be able to take that much in from other people. I can't do it. I'm sorry. I'm not there.
My husband has that skill.
Does he?
He does. He can remember a person's name forever
God, not
from
me.
One time. And he can remember phone numbers. And I know nobody knows
phone numbers.
That's
what I was going to say. It's 2019.
Anymore.
Who knows a phone number?
But let me tell you, in the 80s and the 90s, I'm like, hey, what's this number? What's that number?
I mean, I knew it back then.
Yeah. I still remember my home number growing up.
Me too. So actually, Aaron and I, my boyfriend, we went to Mexico. Gosh, I guess it's been 2 years ago. Before we left, we were like, we have to memorize each other's phone numbers in case there's an emergency and something happens. And so I remembered his phone number, and we ended up having a situation. I walked out of the airport. I don't even know what I was doing. And I turned around, like, couldn't get back in. And I was like, I don't have any of my stuff. I don't know what to do. And so I was like, I need to call him. And I knew his number. I know. So it was like, okay, we have to memorize each other's numbers now. So I actually know his number now, but before then, with no idea.
I love it. I love it.
I don't have that skill.
I don't have that skill either. If you dance it, if you sing it, if you tell me a story about it, you put a color on it, I will never forget. Usually life doesn't work like that.
What? Are you kidding me?
It does.
So you practiced on USARA, you studied on USARA. How did you end up here in Chapel Hill in your own studio space doing your thing?
Yeah, so this is kind of a new venture for us to have our own studio.
It's so beautiful.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thousand Petals Yoga. Mm-hmm. A friend of mine, Maria, who also loves Wilmington. Maria Ibanez Lopez, she helped me design it. She's just one of my friends who loves beauty.
Does she live here?
She did live here.
I feel like I know her name from somewhere.
She's now in Asheville.
She's a yoga teacher?
She's a yogini. She should be a yoga teacher. Maria, I know you hear me.
No pressure.
Yeah. She's definitely one of the people. So she helped me manifest this vision. And so Paul and I never wanted our own yoga studio. And
we famous are last words, huh?
Still wrestling with this, I gotta be honest. But that's the beauty of the Guru Principle. So we were teaching at local studios for years. We've been here nearly 16 years in the Chapel Hill area. We had a brief venture up in the D.C. area. Willow Street Yoga was our home. We love that studio.
I'm
that
from
community.
Outside of D.C. Oh, one of our paths across before.
Yes, love that whole area. Mm-hmm. So many great yogis. And
I'm from Western Maryland.
Okay.
There was no yoga there, but Western Maryland is really close to Central Maryland and Eastern Maryland because it's a tiny little state.
Tiny state.
Yeah.
Lots of yoga.
Yeah.
Lots of stressed out people.
Oh, and angry.
Yes.
Every time I go back to Maryland, I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot everyone hates each other here.
Yeah, the driving. My last like moment there where my heart was open to it, we were on the beltway sitting in traffic, I think coming from IKEA, and we had a class to go teach and could not get there. And it was like 2 miles away. We're sitting on the highway, not moving. I had to pee.
I was silently
crying, tears down my face. I look over and the guy in the car next to me was just flat staring at me with no emotion. I was like, that's it. We're selling our house. We're out of here.
Sorry, Maryland. I know there's probably plenty of nice people in Maryland, but I feel like I don't go back often, but when I do, the few times, I'm like, everyone's really mean to each other here. And I can feel myself acting that way too. Like I start to, I need to practice yoga when I'm driving. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
I'm not the world's most relaxed driver. I like to honk my horn. I can't help it, you know, but I get to Maryland and I'm like, oh my God, everyone's scaring the shit out of me right now.
I surrender.
Yeah. I surrender. Drive our little white flag.
Peace, you win.
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt very satisfied teaching up there. I felt like I was doing a real service. Like these people are stressed.
Yeah.
This is really good work.
Yeah.
So I'm very grateful for that experience. And we came down here. My family's from Atlanta. My husband's from the Maryland, D.C. area. And we have taught at all these wonderful little small local studios. And finally, this year, we got news that the studio we had been teaching out of was losing lease on the room that we use. And so we've had this really dear other studio owner, Franklin Street Yoga. Give a shout out to Lori. We love you.
Yeah, I like to take her classes. I took her classes, I think, every day last year after Hurricane Florence because I was stuck here. I couldn't get home. So I practiced with her many times.
Lori's got a heart of gold.
Yeah.
And she's one who walks the walk.
Mm-hmm.
It's a vulnerable thing. So her studio is literally across the sidewalk from ours. this space is co-owned with her. We share it. She runs some bar and boot camp classes and runs her yoga studio classes right there across. And she called us and was like, look, this is weird, but I have this space. I know you're looking for a home. We hadn't spoken with her for 10 years, and she so graciously welcomed us here.
That's really nice.
Talk about community, talk about power and vulnerability. And I am just so happy to break apart the density of the strange, like, competitive yoga teacher thing.
I was just thinking about this, about how amazing it is that this is a testament to the fact, I say this all the time, there's room for us all.
There's room.
There could be 25 yoga studios in this courtyard right now.
Yeah.
There's room for us all.
Yeah, there's a different voice for everyone. There's mm-hmm. a different flavor. There's room. There's room. There's room. And part of our agreement, and I'm saying, like, with God, with the universe, if we're supposed to do this, because it's been kind of shoved in our face, so we accept the challenge for the studio, and we're taking it on as an art project and mm-hmm. as a community mm-hmm. project. We've sat down with our amazing teachers and have created this mission statement and this shared vision that we are a non-competitive teaching environment.
Oh, that's amazing!
That we celebrate diversity of people, races, gender. We celebrate different ways of teaching yoga. Everyone has different gifts. We attend each other's classes.
Oh, this is so amazing.
Cross promote. Like, that is the groundwork.
Mm-hmm.
And another piece of groundwork, which is really dear to my heart, is the invitation and freedom to the teachers to speak up if they're feeling burnt out, if they're feeling uninspired. Mm.
Because it happens. There's a misconception that yoga teachers just love every day that they come in and teach. I mean, not that I've ever hated a day that I've gone in to teach, but we get worn out.
Yeah.
It's a tremendous amount of giving. Compassion fatigue is real.
Yes. And like anything, we have to rest. We have mm-hmm. to replenish. So we have room for that. You know, we're finding our way. We're co-creating our way. But we've been at this for, you know, over 20 years just teaching. We have such an incredible local community. I can honestly say that we don't just have classes of people, we have a community.
One of the things I noticed right off the bat when I walked in yesterday, my first class here, obviously my first class with you, is the room. It was people of all ages
yeah.
and of all sizes and abilities taking the same class. And I mean, I know lots of yoga studios, they have like level one or open level classes that are for everyone, but I felt like that was a really interesting group of people that had this amazing practice together, and everyone was doing things and no one felt left behind. It was really incredible to be a part of.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. That is one of my greatest gifts in my life. I look out at the room of people, and I know everybody in the room has their whole universe, right? With so many things in a room, someone's going through cancer, someone's lost someone, someone's just had a baby and celebrating a marriage, whatever these things mm-hmm. are, all of humanity is within a room. And then I'm looking across and I'm seeing different bodies, different ages. And not only that we're practicing together, but these people know each other's name. We share meals together. We do community things together. We laugh, we cry together. If I have a need, I can pick up the phone and call someone. I've had people step in as like surrogate grandparents to my kids because our
That's
family
so cool.
isn't in state. It is real deal community, and it is the greatest gift in my life.
It's really amazing.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad I got to be a part of it yesterday.
Yes.
Yeah. This is slightly off topic, but it just thinking of your class yesterday, you know, sometimes you take yoga classes and you hear these things 1,000 times and then one day you're like, oh yeah, duh. So yesterday in Urdhva Dhanurasana, you mentioned, you said, if you can't breathe, it's not worth it. And of course I know this. And of course I know, like, you should be breathing, but how many times do we actually hold our breath in yeah. the yoga practice? But that contextualized it a little bit differently for me yesterday. I was like, damn it, she's right. It's not worth it. Let me get out of here.
It's so good.
You know, because usually what I do is I'm like, okay, now I have to try to breathe. And it becomes such a struggle
yeah.
to do it. And I was like, it's just not worth it.
Yeah.
Is it? And it was one of those moments, so simple, but so clear. So thanks.
Oh, you're welcome. I love it.
Yeah.
I don't think that I really breathed for 10 years in my yoga practice. Like, I don't think my breath was, I wasn't yet ready for mm-hmm. breath. I mean, it was happening, but to really do breath work is a subtle layer that shows itself when you're ready for it. And obviously you want to breathe, but to really begin to work with the breath begins to work with all the subtle body energy and all the power and all these emotions.
Well, not that the eight limbs have to be followed in the exact path, but it's not pranayama is not number one.
Right.
It's not number one. There's a lot of things, until you get there. I take ballet classes on Mondays and I catch myself every time we balance. And when we come out of it, I'm like, I do yoga every day. How did I forget to breathe doing that? As soon as I have to get in the balance, I'm like, I don't know why. It's so hard to remember.
Yeah. I'm helping my daughter do math facts and I'm holding my breath.
That's I don't know if I mentioned this on the podcast before, but everyone as a child told me I wasn't good at math. And so I believed it. I didn't do well in math until one day I didn't even know what happened. I just started doing well in math in college. I was like, oh, actually turns out I'm pretty good in math. And then I scored higher in math on my GREs, higher in math and anything else, even my language stuff. So maybe I can breathe while I'm doing math and didn't know it. And maybe you can too.
Ew.
Yeah.
I actually think I would love math if it was presented to me as poetry and art.
So one thing that helped me is someone told me math is a language, so you have to treat it like a language, and that helped because it wasn't this like thing I was resisting. I was like, I just have to learn how to speak it, And then the other thing is, and maybe this isn't the best advice to aspiring mathematicians out there, but I'm not a mathematician. Someone else told me just to stop asking why. And that actually really helped me because I was like, well, why? Well, at that moment, it didn't matter why.
Yeah.
Then it started to make sense. The why, and in fact, sort of like the yoga practice, right? That unfolds with time. You can't force the revelation, It will just unfold. So that really helped me too.
Okay.
I don't know, but I've heard that math is totally different now for kids learning. I don't know how math is different, but I hear.
My daughter learns through the Waldorf school these amazing ways that I wish I could have learned. They do hand clapping and gestures and jumping and ball throwing.
Oh, I didn't learn like that.
Just with the body.
That's amazing and really important.
Yeah.
I mean, there's so much research out there that talks about the importance of using the body while learning.
Yes.
Because, of course, we're in our bodies while we're learning,
Yeah. Movement, breath, it's all linked up. They know what they're doing.
For sure. So, Summer, tell me, is there anything else that you want to share with the Dharma Drops audience?
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, what have we not covered?
I will say, I'll give a brief snippet just to pop any bubbles that people may have of yogis in general. Ooh. We all have a story. Mm-hmm. And my origin story, my husband and I came out of the nightclub business.
Oh.
And we don't have your traditional walkway into yoga. We came from late nights, lots of alcohol and other substances. Just the whole business, we would go to bed at 6 a.m. when the sun was rising. Mm-hmm. Our lives were totally out of sync. And it was a fun time. I have no regrets. We had the opportunity, it was called Yin Yang Cafe, the small business and cafe. And then he opened what's called Kaya, was called Kaya, it's now closed. It was a huge nightclub. But Yin Yang was this incredible brick, small, yummy cafe that all the jazz cats ended up claiming as their own. And so we got to meet all of the most incredible jazz musicians.
That's amazing.
On a very intimate level. Yeah, they would come after the big show and hang out. Mm. And it was just such an incredible time of life. But all this is to say, we came out of addiction and hardcore addiction. Being alive is a miracle, especially for my husband. Mm-hmm. And he hasn't really shared that story much. I'm not going to share his story for him. But when I see people walk in who I can kind of see it on them, right? Because I know it so intimately. And I can see they're struggling and wanting to be better and healing themselves. I am just so grateful to have found a practice and to be able to share a practice with people going through that. Because I really believe if you move the body, if you're replacing that energy with movement, it's redirecting it. You're never going to get rid of that, what I'm saying, the addictive energy. It's creative energy. It's inherently mm-hmm. neutral energy, but it doesn't have a vessel. Or it gets misplaced, and it's actually profound energy of creation. People who have a lot of addiction, as we know,
amazing artists.
Amazing, mm-hmm. amazing. So it's not that it's a bad thing that you have this force in you. You don't know what to do with it, but you have to learn how to channel it. And so I have watched people go through methadone, you know, go through all the intensive treatments and not really know how to transform it. And it wasn't until I noticed in my own body and my husband's body and also in others that until you add this piece of the physicality of movement, that it would really then seal the deal. It would help truly create a path of freedom outside of that, and then help you learn how to work with that and channel it into healthier ways.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to say yoga as a real path for healing addiction is profound. And on just a personal note, you know, I've walked through a lot of darkness. I've walked through a lot of pain and personal healing, and haven't worked it all out, right? That's what life is about.
I was going to say, that's life, right?
That's life. It's rich and it's deep. And I am so grateful for the color of all of that, because it is the healer's path, and it allows me to meet other people who are going through really deep, deep mm-hmm. wounds and believe in them. And even on the level of first doing yoga, I could not touch my toes. My hamstrings were so mm-hmm. tight. I mean, I was crying emotionally, but also physically. It just was awful. But I came back for Shavasana.
Everyone comes back for Shavasana. Yeah.
But that, I believe in people, because, you know, having walked through it, I know it. I know if you stick with mm-hmm. it, it's the real deal. You will.
Consistent effort over time, it yeah. will transform.
It will transform.
You know, I think everyone can correct me if I'm wrong about this, but I'm pretty sure it was Iyengar BKS Iyengar who talked about when you align the body physically. He said that it channels the energy of God, and you can replace that with whatever you want. But it makes me think a little bit about what you're saying. Just movement in the body, it creates this pathway
yeah.
for all that energy, the stuck energy, the creative energy, and we just become so aware.
Yeah.
About the choices we make and where our energy goes and what we want to create with our lives,
yes.
you know, and you wouldn't think that, oh, descending my femur bone in Warrior 2 would do that, but it creates the pathway.
It creates the mm-hmm. pathway. I love that.
Me too. When I read that, one of those quotes where I was like, oh, got it.
Mm-hmm. yeah. I always remember his quote, the body is my prayer.
Mm.
There's another piece to it. The asana, maybe asana is the form, but the body is my prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe I'm totally breaking this up, but
we get the spirit of it.
And yeah, the body's a channel. It's uh-huh. you know, we are all mediums. We're bridges of spirit and embodiment, and we need a clear channel if we're going to awaken to who we really are. And it's not a puritist view of a pure channel, mm-hmm. but it is. What am I here for? And can my body be most vibrant and healthy and alive so that I'm not busy suffering and in mm-hmm. pain, so that I can do the work I'm here to do, so I can choose a path of freedom and joy and celebrate being alive. And that does happen to include eating healthy, beautiful foods, because that gives me a clearer and steady mind and allows me presence, and presence is love. And then I love others and I love life.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not a to-do list, like you do yoga and then you eat well and then
check,
you have
check.
To do. Yeah, they all circle in.
Right. You know, you hear these things all the time, one good choice leads to another. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's really how the yoga practice is. What's the word I'm looking for? I guess I'll just call it choice. One choice in my yoga practice just leads to another good choice. That's yeah. why I left yoga yesterday and I was like, ooh, I want something really healthy to eat.
Yes.
you know, it, and it's just, and often I'll leave yoga and be like, you know, I think I'm in the mood to read some of my spiritual texts today. You know, it just one choice leads to another one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, this has been amazing. Summer, if people want to learn more about you or find out more about your amazing yoga studio, where can they find you?
They can find us at 1000.com. petalsyoga.com.
And best website.
Spelled out. Thank you. TheusandPetals.com. We get a lot of people writing pedals, like bike pedals.
Oh.
It's not that.
Could you imagine a bike with 1,000 pedals,
right?
Though?
I'm in. I'll try it. And there we have info on our studio. We also have online yoga classes.
Oh,
we have retreats.
Nice.
We have just tons of amazing good things happening. It's kind of exploding. Jupiter is happening in landing this year in major ways.
I don't know anything about this stuff, so I'm glad you're here to tell me.
Okay, so you should check out Stephen Forrest's book on astrology, Inner Sky.
Sky.
If you're 101 astrology people, and if you're like into astrology and you're poo-pooing this, so sorry, but as a beginner, it's masterful and helpful workbook, and you'll learn Jupiter is like the big, it magnifies, it's the guru energy. So it makes everything more expansive and more blingy. So there's a lot of growth.
That explains a lot about my life this year. It's been a really amazing year. I'm not sure what's happening. I don't even care. I just let whatever happens, happens. But it's been a really expansive year, to say the least.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Bring it. Me too.
Ooh.
And buckle
She's
up.
She's like, bring it, Jupiter.
Bring it and buckle up. And Jupiter, you humbled me. Okay.
Like, do you know that in my intro, it says, buckle up, giddy up. Here we go. That's it. Buckle up, Jupiter.
Buckle up. My knees are shaking, but I'm on the rocket. Let's go.
So before we part ways, I always like to end the, each episode where I talk about things that have nothing to do with yoga, because I think it's really important for yogis to remember that we can live all of this and have it in our hearts all the time. But there's just really cool stuff out there that's not yoga.
Yeah.
And for me, I got so wrapped up in yoga for a while that I just stopped having fun. You know, I think that happens to a lot of yogis in the beginning, actually. So are there things that you're doing right now that you just really enjoy? Any TV shows, podcasts, books, vacations, anything?
Well, Italy.
Yeah.
That is definitely, we just came back from Ischia after our retreat. We traveled to this little amazing island. So that's on my mind and in my heart. I am really geeking out into astrology in the sense that I've had my chart read before by others.
Have you ever had your Vedic astrology stuff read? I've been wanting to do that, but I haven't done it.
Yes, I right now don't know of anyone to point to, but it is so interesting because the reading allows for the movement of the stars, and so the universe hasn't been the same, right, ever since these systems came in. So your sign, depending on when you were born, might be actually different. You might fall into a different house. So I can't speak too much on it. I have had readings there that have been mind-blowing.
And that's cool.
Yeah, right now my passion is in basically kind of like the math that we're talking about. If you spend a weekend learning the symbols and learning the language of astrology, and you look at your own natal chart, you have a map of your life, of your deepest path of awakening, your work, your challenges, all your shadow. It is laid out there for you to see, but you have to learn the language.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so profound to me, not just to have another person read my chart. I've had great readings and so many insights through it and will continue to do that. But to learn how to read one's own chart, to me, takes out this other filter and allows you to penetrate through layers where you know there's truth there. And so that's kind of where I'm.
That's really cool. I want to get my stuff read. So I've never really had much done with that, but my boyfriend's parents, they're probably the most beautiful couple you've ever seen. They love each other more than anyone I've ever seen that love each other. And they got married on the winter solstice. Ooh. Let's see, Aaron, he'll turn 40 tomorrow. So I guess about 41 years ago. And they got married on the winter solstice. But when I met them, they told me that they were an astrologer or whatever. Told them that together their signs are the whole universe, which I thought was really amazing.
That
I know, and you can see it in them too. It's really amazing.
Auspicious love. Mm-hmm. Wow.
There's something else. I've talked about them a lot on the podcast because they followed Ram Dass. I mean, they were like hippies in the 60s. And in fact, Aaron's dad just the other day was talking about how much weed he smoked while making macrame in the 60s and how he learned about the spirit through smoking weed and making macrame.
It's all right there.
Yeah. like, is that all I have to do is smoke a little weed and make a macrame pot holder?
Wow. You have amazing in-laws. That's
it was incredible. Aaron and I were like, is he talking about this?
It's a portal. It's an entry point. I love that. I want to learn macrame.
Me too. I feel like macrame would look really beautiful in your studio, actually. Yeah. Like when those little hanging, maybe Aaron's dad will make one for you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's so funny.
Do your thing.
Anything else exciting happening? Is that your big thing right now?
Well, I'm also very... So I just had this realization about myself yesterday.
Oh, I'm really excited that you get to share it today.
This is big, yeah. 24-hour news break. So I've returned back to my Vitamix and my juicer.
Oh, I love my Vitamix.
Love it. And I have deep roots. I'm a student of Ayurveda forever and ever.
I love Ayurveda. I teach Ayurvedic yoga.
Oh, lovely. Mm-hmm. You should come to your class. Yeah, pacify my Vata.
Yeah.
So I always play the edge in this realm because this is what I learned about myself. I don't like cooking.
Mm.
Okay. I've really wrestled with this. But I do love making raw milks and raw desserts.
Oh my God, I need you. I cannot make these milks. They always turn out nasty. Yeah,
with Ayurvedic powders and all the potions that I blend in.
Ooh, potions.
Potions, herbs, and all the yummy flowers. I've studied herbalism for years. I've studied
that's amazing.
Herbs. And so I'm just always playing around. And I realized while I was making my concoctions yesterday that kind of food preparation, I can't call it cooking, but it feels like magic, and it's so beautiful looking and tasting and full of life. And if I can tweak it with Ayurvedic principles, like I'll put the cardamom, the cinnamon in, make it warmer, then it just is like, I don't know, it's my art right now, my nectar. So raw desserts, raw milks, raw hot chocolate.
Oh my gosh, I want to do some. So do you have a cookbook or something that you recommend for these things?
Oh.
I feel like you're full of really good recommendations.
Living Cuisine.
Living Cuisine.
That book I lived through probably for 2 years. It's a raw dessert cookbook. There's like, I don't know, maybe a $35 raw pie in there. That's what I call it, the $35 pie.
The other day, I wanted to make this stuff, so I've been getting acupuncture because I've had this like chest stuff. I'm really into Chinese medicine right now. It's like changing my life.
Yes.
But my acupuncturist said I need to make what's called lung soup for my chest, and it's just white vegetables, you know, and she recommends chicken broth. If you're vegan, you can use vegetable broth, whatever. But Aaron was like, this is $100 soup. That's what he called it. He was like, because all these ingredients just cost $100. And he was like scooping up. He's like, y'all want some $100 soup?
It was a $25 bowl right here. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of over the top, ridiculous. But I will say that cookbook will teach you, if you are willing to go there a little bit, you don't have to make all of the things, but it has so many inspirations for raw desserts that aren't just like your average avocado chocolate pudding, which I love.
It's good.
But it's elevated. Like add raw chocolate avocado pudding with cashew cream with
a layer of cashew cream,
strawberry, raw strawberry with, you know, then you put your cardamom and all that. I tweak it.
See, I like what you said about it being beautiful too, because that comes back to the attention thing we were talking about, because when there's like a decadence to it, but there's also something that feels really good to like use all these things. And I feel like I'm more present in the kitchen versus like dumping in a bunch of cans of shit and throwing it, you know, and stirring it in a pot, you know?
Yes, that's not my style of cooking. Beauty is the goddess. Beauty for me, I have my moon in Libra, okay? This is what I'm just learning. Beauty is a language of the soul. It feeds the soul. It's the Italian culture thing again, or all the European culture, I'll give it to them. Just that it matters. If you're living in an environment with natural beauty, your whole being is being fed in a way. If you're living in a concrete jungle with metal everywhere and trash and loud noises, it's cold and it's painful for the spirit. So for me, beauty isn't about buying a bunch of stuff, but it's the care and the loving presence for one's environment, or the way that you adorn yourself as the respect of the divinity in you and for you and for others, but for an expression of the celebration of life.
God, I feel like the next time I'm in town, we should do an episode about beauty. I'm so intrigued.
Oh, I would love.
Okay, it's happening. It's happening. Good news. I'll be back next weekend because I have tickets to something at DPAC.
Great, let's go.
It's perfect. I think this was amazing.
Thank you
yes,
so much.
Of course.
Thank you.
Anything else you want to share before we part ways with the audience today?
I'm just honored, and thank you for making it easy to make donations.
Yes.
For the hurricane victims in the Bahamas.
Yes,
thank you.
Of course. And just as a reminder, you can make donations at dharmadropspodcast.com/the Bahamas.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And there, I'll share that with my community.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. I'll send you the link. And the link will be in the show notes for those of you listening too. So you can go down there, click the link, and you can donate there. All right. Well, thanks so much, guys, for listening. You can always find me on Instagram at Rebecca Warfield Yoga and at Dharma Drops Podcast. And as always, you can find me online at dharmadropspodcast.com. And, you know, there's probably 1,000 places you can find me on the internet. It's kind of freaky. So just Google me. I'm there. All right, guys, until we meet again next time. Bye.
Bye.
Hey, thanks for listening to this episode of Dharma Drops Podcast. Don't forget to head over to Facebook and join the Dharma Drops community page where we can hang out, share ideas, have fun, and just shoot the shit together. So head over to Facebook, search for Dharma Drops community page, and bada bing, bada boom, you're there. On Instagram, you can find me at Rebecca Warfield Yoga and at Dharma Drops Podcast. And of course, you can always head over to my website, RebeccaWarfield.com and DharmaDropsPodcast.com, and check out all my shenanigans there, including you can register for the Feeding the Wildlife 2-week course on my site. Okay, until we meet again next time. Bye.